It's Kapil, my favorite collaborator, the Eye Institute. We're trying to develop RPE models for screening.
So the tissue that we work on is called the retinal pigment epithelium. It's a monolayer of cells in the back of the eye.
So now we are pulling up. So that's, I think, Ph.D Group Hospital. And on the left is the facility where we are going.
We're interested in this tissue because there are several diseases in which this tissue is damaged, and this damage leads to the damage of or death of photoreceptors and leads to vision loss in those patients.
It's been an exciting collaboration with Kapil, really at the forefront of developing relevant cellular models using iPSDI, RPEs. I must say, been challenging but exciting at the same time.
Yeah. This is kind of a schematic model of how an eye looks like. And this is the front of the eye, this is a lens. The light shines from here and hits this green part, which is a photosensitive retina. So right behind this green part and wrapped around it is this yellow part, which is the pigmented epithelium monolayer. So it's a single layer of cells. And basically, because of its pigmented nature, it acts as a light screen and doesn't let the light hit the brain. And in addition, this layer performs several other critical functions for protecting or maintaining the health and integrity of retinal photoreceptors. And these include, for instance, providing them with nutrient supply from the blood and taking care of metabolites that photoreceptors secrete and transporting them to blood.
You know what, I have to complain to you. This yeast assay is killing, like, these are DMSO plates, man.
So this is a typical interaction. See, you're on camera.
I just want this to be documented. No, let me do one thing and I'll be right back.
Sam is a robotic engineer that programmed the robot, and now he's giving me grief because one of the assays is really difficult.
For the first time, this is possible that actually you can take patient cells and be able to study their disease processes in a dish.
On a robot, we cannot do everything that a biologist might do on the bench. So part of our job is to take a protocol that Kapil might develop that has steps that really we cannot do, and sort of eliminate those steps or streamline the protocol so it can be done on the robot. What the human does in the lab, these robots can do for like millions of wells and millions of compounds. With Kapil, we have an RPE system. So we know it works, we have miniaturized it, and now we're gonna test compounds to see the effect of these compounds in the biology that we're looking at for RPEs.
People have shown previously that if you replace the damaged tissue with healthy tissue from another part of the eye, you're able to restore vision in those patients. So if we were able to make RPE not from the eye itself, but from another tissue of the body, we would provide perhaps beneficial effects for the patients. And that's where the iPS technology comes into picture, because iPS technology allows you to make autologous cells from a patient and then be able to differentiate those cells into any tissue, in this case, the pigment epithelium. So we could take your skin cells or blood cells, reprogram them into iPS cells, and then differentiate those iPS cells into RPE, and then use those RPE cells as a replacement tissue. And this is one typical example of a dish where we have made RPE cells from iPS cells, and you can see that all the wells are full of pigmented cells, that you can see this black color here, which are all RPE cells. And if you do fax analysis to check how pure these are, then you can easily get more than 90% RPE cells from any given well at a point. We wanted to make cells that and authenticate them functionally to show that these cells really function like in vivo RPE cells. So we grow our cells on a biodegradable scaffold, and that whole tissue is mounted in these physiology rigs, and we measure the function of the entire tissue, and we check that the tissue is electrically and mechanically intact. And then we check their intracellular pH, calcium, and their ability to transport water and other nutrients. And the new thing was the way we grew cells in a polarized fashion on it. So we came up with a method to screw down the scaffold onto the semi-permeable transwell membrane and then grow cells on top of it. So with the medium on both top and bottom and just providing a basal surface, the cells would grow polarized on it. But then we could also take out the intact tissue from this when it was ready and mature, and be able to test it functionally. One of the big advantages of the iPS cell technology is that you get to take samples directly from patients and from their families, their healthy siblings and their parents, so which are genetically very close to each other, and be able to make convert those iPS cells, so take the patient samples, convert them into iPS, and convert the iPS into desired cell type, which in our case is retinal pigment epithelium, and then be able to study disease processes in vitro. So in this particular case, Katharina has cells from a family that has a condition called late onset retinal degeneration. And we have made iPS cell lines from patients and their healthy siblings. And she has converted those iPS cells into RPE, and now is characterizing that RPE cells to see what kind of disease processes have come up in those RPE cells that are a result of the mutation that happened only in the patients, not in the healthy siblings. I think the biggest really power of being at NIH is the resources that are available. And really, I think, and the drive to do a more clinical work, more translational work. And really all these resources gear you, kind of easily channelize you, funnel you towards clinical work. You know, all this power of the clinical center, access to patients is so easy. I'm in a branch that is a clinical branch. My branch chief is he's a clinician who is very well supportive of us doing getting access to the patients, and we have joint lab meetings where we can discuss. My folks can learn more about the clinical aspects of the same things they're working on in the lab. And then access to NCATS, which is a wonderful resource to do translational work for screening and high throughput assays. So I think those are really some of the key things that NIH should do and does very well. And that, I think, for me, really has kept me at NIH, because I think all this access to wonderful translational resources is great.
This facility started like as the NIH Chemical Genomics Center about 10 years ago as a center to help academic investigators and NIH investigators to find small molecule probes to validate the function of genes. So it included the screening group, as well as a chemistry, medicinal chemistry group, as well as informatics group. And the idea is to have a collection of compounds that you can screen on biological assays to try to find a small molecules that modulate biologies, whether it's a sort of phenotypic assay or some sort of target, biological target. And then to use chemistry to improve the potency of the compound and selectivity of the compound for your biology of interest.
Doing all of this whole day from morning to evening, I enjoy every single minute of it. There's not a minute when I say, oh gosh, what is that? There are challenges, you know, there are water leaks and there are contaminations, but nevertheless, I enjoy every single minute of it. Talking to people, troubleshooting their projects, discussing the next step, writing publications, thinking about the clinical trial, thinking about doing collaborative work with everybody kind of in a pre-competitive space, making resources for the entire community. Everything is fun, talking to NCATS, screening assays, I love it. I think to me, this is, for me, this is a dream that came true in my life.